Before I get started, a surgeon, an engineer, and a politician were debating which of their professions was the best, and the discussion turned to which was the oldest. Well, if it was the oldest, that must have been the best profession, because it was the first. The surgeon said Eve was made from Adam's rib, and that, of course, was a surgical procedure. So, obviously, surgery is the best profession. The engineer countered and said no, but before that, order was created out of chaos. And that most certainly was an engineering feat. So engineering is the best. The politician smiled triumphantly and said, aha, and just who do you think created all the chaos? I think we can all confirm that this is what politicians do, they create chaos. Have any of you ever been in a chaotic situation? Are you familiar with chaos? Jordan is shaking her head, yes. Anyone with kids typically knows what chaos is like at least one point in their life. You're familiar with it. You know what craziness can abound from that. In the company that I work for, we have a specific way of doing things. It's called lean manufacturing. Within that lean, there is a system called 5S. Gary knows about 5S because the PUD is trying to adopt our lean culture. We don't know anymore. But, there are five Japanese words, is where this is derived from. Roughly translated, it's sort, straighten, sweep, standardize, and sustain. Those are the five words, the 5S. The idea is that once you have a 5S process, that it will give good flow to your production line. Things will flow. There won't be any chaos, because you've implemented something that gets rid of the chaos. Those who stick with that prescribed process get order. Those who do not, read only chaos, and nothing good comes from out of that chaos. More chaos. And if you have a sensei that you pay $50,000 to come tell you how to do that, and he comes back 6 months later and sees that you're still in chaos, it's not a good day for the people who are working with that sensei. Paul also knows about chaos. He's been trying to correct this from the beginning. The Corinthian church is chaotic. He's been trying to show the Corinthian church the best way. He said in chapter 13, I will show you a more perfect way, a complete way. Since chapter 12, we've been focusing on spiritual gifts and the proper use of them. It's been a big deal in the Corinthian church of the improper use of these gifts that have been given to them. Today we're going to finish out chapter 14, and he's going to bring the idea to a perfect point, to completion, the more perfect way. We talked about it at 13, he kind of interjected the idea of love. This is the perfect way. This is how you accomplish order out of chaos. It's love. So, read with me, if you will, starting in verse 26. Paul says, what is the outcome then, brethren, when you assemble each one as a psalm, as a teaching, as a revelation, as a tongue, as an interpretation? Let all things be done for edification. If anyone speaks in a tongue, it should be by two or three at most, and each in turn, and one must interpret. If there is no interpreter, he must keep silent in the church, and let him speak to himself and to God. Let two or three prophets speak, and let the others pass judgment. But if a revelation is made to another who is seated, the first one must keep silent. For you can all prophesy one by one, so that all may learn, and all may be exhorted. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to prophets. God is not a God of confusion, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. The women are to keep silent in those churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but are subject to themselves, just as the law also says. If they desire to learn anything, let them ask their own husbands at home, for it is improper for a woman to speak in the church. Was it from you that the word of God went forth? Or is it to come to you only? If anyone thinks he is a prophet or spiritual, let him recognize that the thing which I write to you as the Lord's command. But if anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. Therefore, my brethren, desire earnestly to prophesy and do not forbid to speak in tongues. But all things must be done properly and in an orderly manner. Paul here is addressing another issue in the church. Their worship was chaotic in Corinth. Their corporate worship was out of control. You see, the key word for the church in Corinth was not edification, as he just said, to edify one another, to build up. The key word was exhibition. That was their word. Exhibit. Put it on display. My gift is better. I have more value. I'm more spiritual than you because I have this gift. They didn't care about the building up of the body, they cared about exhibiting one's own gift. When it came right down to it, they were showing off. Their focus was in all the wrong places. We know that worship is primarily directed towards God. When we gather for worship, it is not for ourselves. It is not entertainment time. It's something that we pay a preacher to come entertain us for a little bit and then go home. We gather together to honor and glorify God. We gather together to get our perspective and the realization that God is the center of our lives, to encourage one another to keep that focus. But also at the same time, how we worship affects others. Shouldn't fail to remember that through worship, and though it is primarily directed towards our Heavenly Father, how we do it when we're together is important as well. We're called to corporate worship. We're called to together, a time of unified worship of our God. Just a second ago, Paul also said, whatever you do, be doing for what? The edification of others, right? So, yes, our worship is directed towards our God. It is done together, and it should be something that edifies one another. We're called to corporate worship, and we're called to gather to be of one voice and one mind. This means that we must consider what we say and how it's going to affect our brother or our sister. This isn't just between you and God. It's between us and God. We should never be flippant or lax in our worship. We should always remember the second purpose of our corporate worship is to let all things God for edification. First God, then the body. We come together to be edified. That is, built up, right? Instructed, encouraged together. We come to learn together. Sometimes we need to be comforted together. How do we accomplish that? How is that attained? In verses 26 through 28, Paul kind of tells us that we need to abandon any type of competition. He says, what then, when you come together, each has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation, letting all these things be done for the building up, for the edifying. Whenever there's communication, it has to be clear communication. Paul begins this section by listing various means of communicating. Every one of these is some form of communicating. He emphasizes that it's all to have an unwavering purpose, which is edification. The word literally means house building, to build a house. It's the idea that the purpose of the message is to grow, to improve, and to mature the one who hears it. We should always increase in our fullness. We should always be upward moving. Never plateau, because there is no real plateau of Christianity. It's either up or it's down. You don't get this levelness. He said, if there's anybody who wants to speak in a tongue, two or at the most three, right? But if there's no one there to interpret the message, if the message can't be understood, don't say anything. Just say it and be quiet. The Corinthians weren't doing this. They were not interested in helping each other. Instead, they were competing for attention and preeminence among their brethren. Because each one was considering their experiences more legitimate than the others, they became unaccepting and even condescending of others. Maybe, well, you only can speak in tongues and I can prophesy, so just be quiet. I am better. Instead of understanding, the church had bedlam. They had chaos. At the center of that was the use and abuse of these gifts that they were given, not for betterment, just for their simple building up of themselves. Paul says, if no one's there to interpret the message so that all can understand, then it shouldn't happen. It serves no purpose. It's of no value. He moves on from that, 29-33, and he makes the statement that everything should be evaluated when spoken. It should be tested. Right? We see that elsewhere in Scripture as well. He said, where let two or three prophets speak, let the others weigh in what is said, weigh in, discern. Is it right? So that all may learn and be encouraged. God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. That's the abridged version. He wants you to know, does it come from God? Is what is being said from the pulpit come from God, or is it an opinion laced with spiritual or religious words? Right? We're told throughout the word to test the spirits, see if they are from God. This also doesn't just go for the one delivering the message from the pulpit, but I believe it also includes any time we're engaged in conversation. Whenever an idea is brought up, test that idea. Does the idea hold up to Scripture? Because If you're communicating an idea to somebody, you're teaching. And what is being taught should be in accordance with sound doctrine. If myself or anyone else that was up here was quoting something that was a fad type of faith, right? You hear the health and wealth gospels being preached, we know that's not scriptural. That should be addressed. You would pull me aside at the end and be like, so you said some stuff. No. Let's talk about that. It's of no good, of no use for me to get up here and preach something that sounds good, that's enjoyable, but has no real spiritual value, that doesn't build you up spiritually. God is also about order. He's not ordered when there is disharmony, frenzy, or any kind of competition. For there is chaos and discord, the Spirit is not in control. He tells the prophets that they control the spirit of the prophet. They can control what is being said. It doesn't just come out. It doesn't just fall out. Weigh your words. Before you say it, test what you're going to say. Is what you're going to say in accordance with the Word of God? God has given us roles and order of authority. We've already gone over this. 1 Corinthians is replete with order of authority. 34, 35, which is not a popular verse for people to preach on, because everybody's like, that's sexist. Wrong title. It's in the Bible. Can it be misunderstood and can it be misapplied? Yeah, it can. So, let's look at this verse a little bit. Context here is important. This set of verses should not be separated from the rest of the thought. It would be ridiculous to think that if you're talking about tongue speaking and prophecy, that all of a sudden it goes to a different idea. I don't believe it does. And I don't believe the evidence in Scripture shows that. Is Paul teaching that women are not to make a single sound in the assembly? No. Shake your head, no. You couldn't sing. You couldn't affirm with an amen. You couldn't talk at all. Because the word is silent total. Do not make a noise. He tells those tongue speakers, don't make a noise. Just shut your mouth. Prophets, if one gets up to speak, you sit down, you just shut your mouth. The word is saying use care. So he's not telling them, don't make a sound, or else you would not be able to fulfill every other commandment in the assembly. So, maintain context. Is he instructing the women to remain silent regarding the spiritual gifts that they possessed? Did these women possess spiritual gifts? Check your head. Yes, they did. We have evidence for that. We know that women possess spiritual gifts, like Philip's four daughters who prophesied in Acts 21, verse 9. We also know the instructions given to women with gifts earlier in this very letter, chapter 11, verse 5. When they prophesied, they had their head covered, right? A sign of authority. But they had gifts. The same ones that we're talking about now. So therefore, just as tongue speakers and prophets were given instructions regarding their gifts, couldn't women also be given those same instructions? Or the type of instruction based upon that same idea? The answer, based on context, is yes. This is a very hard study. This took me a lot. I talked with three different preachers while we were at Faith Builders, and I asked them, give me their insight on the scripture. Didn't get a lot of, yeah, that's a good answer, go with that one. I got a lot of, that's a hard verse. I go, thanks, well, that's why I asked. I got a lot of help, though, and I'm appreciative of that help. You'd have to ask, why would it be the case that women are singled out in this specific instance? Doesn't saying tongue speakers and prophets be quiet cover everybody? Well, there's a specific instance of why it's necessary for women not to use their spiritual gifts in the assembly. Paul indicates in verse 34 that for women to speak would mean that they would be forfeiting the submission that the law of God said. So, again, go back to order of authority. How would women speaking cause a breaking of God's law concerning submission? Think about this for a moment. The scripture teaches that the wife is to be submissive to her husband. You see it in Ephesians, Corinthians, Colossians, 1 Peter. Does this mean that the wife cannot speak to her husband? No. Has anybody got a marriage in here that works and not talking? No, okay. There you go. I kind of blows that out of the water. The point of considering is that speaking does not equal a lack of submission. So we must ask the question, why is this brought out? Why does this equal a lack of submission? The conclusion could be, and I say could be, because I'm still not 100% that I am correct on this, but this is the one that makes the most sense. The person talking or leading in the assembly, right, this usually goes hand in hand. I am right now leading us in the assembly because I'm speaking for from the Word of God to you. The song leader leads the worship service in song. A prayer leader leads in song, or leads prayer, excuse me. So, when the prophet spoke, the rest would be silent and evaluate what's being said. It goes on down the line and sets up the idea that this is an authoritative position. And 1 Timothy 2:11, 12 backs up Paul here when he writes to Timothy later. It says, a woman must quietly receive instruction with entire submissiveness. I do not allow a woman to teach or exercise authority over a man, but to remain quiet. The idea is not that they couldn't talk, that talking was bad. It was exercising authority. It was over other men. And that was the idea that Paul was talking about. People like to go with the simple answer sometimes because it's easy. They don't want to put in the time to study. If I were to go in with the easy answer is, oh, gotta be quiet, sorry. That's not. Context doesn't lend to that. That's not the right answer. He moves on from order of authority, and he says that we must accept true authority. Verses 36 through 38. He says, or was it from you that the word of God came? And he's being really sarcastic here. You can really hear Paul's sarcastic tone. Or are you the only ones it reached? Are you the first church, basically? Are you Jerusalem? Did everything just come and start here? No. You guys are way later. Calm down. He says, if anyone thinks that he's a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I'm writing to you are a command of God. If anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. So there, if what I'm saying to you isn't received, then you're kind of discounting God here. And so, God does not recognize you as any kind of spiritual man or prophet. You are nothing. He says that to recognize that our reception of the truth is not unique. Just because we have the truth doesn't mean that we're special. A lot of other people have it too and have had it before us. Paul wants them to be clearly thinking in the idea that no one can claim any special revelation. There's nothing specific here. Everybody has the truth. In addition, tongues, interpretation, and prophecy will not add anything to the Word of God. Nothing extra is going to come out of those gifts. Unfortunately, the Corinthians had the audacity to place themselves above Scripture and above Paul. Paul refutes that soundly, and like I said, he has a little bit of sarcasm there. He's like, who are you? You're nobody. Calm down. If we are truly spiritual people, we will recognize the authority of God's word, and we will submit to that authority. Acts 2:38 is a verse that everybody here is probably pretty familiar with. We don't really have to look it up to know it. Repent, each one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and be baptized, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. All too often, there are those that will argue the point, well, you don't have to be baptized to be forgiven. Peter didn't really mean that when he said that. It means something totally different. It's out of context. Well, prove it. You can't. And it's there. Not the only verse that supports that idea. So, when you assume that you have it right, when you assume that you have the original meaning, an inspiration of Scripture, if you have to set aside scriptures that say otherwise to maintain your position, it's false confidence. That's not reality. So we should be clear at this point that no believer has the right to overrule, ignore, alter, or disobey the Word of God based on a feeling or a dream or anything like that. Everything has to be in accordance with the Word of God. We should also be prepared for corporate worship. Be prepared. 39 through 40, he says, so my brothers earnestly desire to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues. Side point there, notice he doesn't forbid any of that stuff that was being misused. He says, do it. I gave you how to do it now, but still do it. Still use your gift. Don't shirk back because you messed up. Do it right. But all things should be done decently and in order. This has a mandate for it. Everything that you do, it doesn't matter what it is. Do it right. Decently means correct, right? In accordance with the will of God. In accordance with your brother. In accordance with the people that you worship with. Corporate worship is to be characterized by thoughtful care. In Corinth, spontaneity had turned it into chaos and self-indulgence. It started out with, yeah, free, do whatever we want. And then it turned it into a bad thing. It was corrupt. Paul wants them to know that the proclamation of the truth, the word of God, is the most important thing. It is this that builds, comforts, and encourages. So the gathered worship was not to be a free-for-all. It was not to be unplanned. It was a balance between freedom and structure, and it had to be found and applied. Find the balance. Everything was to be done decently in order, Paul says. He says, when you come, you should come prepared. Come with your prophecy. Come with your tongue speaking. But do it so it edifies the body. Whatever you're doing, make sure it builds up, then it doesn't tear down. When you give, as we did this morning, you give purposely, purposefully, with the amount that you set aside. You said, this is what I can give, this is what I desire to give, I'm happy to give this, and I give it. It's not last minute, oh, let me see what I got in my pocket. And usually it's nothing in my pocket, so there would be nothing. It's intentional. Worship is intentional. All these things are intentional. They're planned out. If we wouldn't give that way, then we shouldn't worship that way. You're also the person that says, well, God doesn't care about how we worship. Just do it. Now, yes, just worship God. I agree with that. But he does care how. He does care that everybody corporately worshiping together is built up by how we worship together. It's a selfish statement to say that I'm just going to do however I want to, because God doesn't care. Instead of considering the rest of the body and those who are ready to worship, the individual is only concerned with what they are doing at the present time. Yeah, they can wait on it. It doesn't matter. Obviously, there are instances where people have something that gets in the way and causes a problem. Those happen. And we need to be understanding of people's problems, things that come up. But if our desire is being of one accord and worship in unity, then each one of us will make the effort to come to an understanding of one another and work toward that goal. It is a unit. It functions together. It does not function independently of one or the other. And that brings us to the end of the lesson and the application for us today. Go back to the beginning where Paul's talking, where he says that all things should be done to build one another up. All things. Right? That covers what? Everything. All things being done to build one another up. Whatever we do, we should be doing it to encourage, to build up. Not of our own selfish motive or our desire, but to grow the body here in Moses Lake. Each one of us has that job. If you don't feel like you have a job, just give me one. There's the job. Build each other up. When I teach a class, or if I preach, whatever I'm doing, my goal should not just be for me to be heard, to stand up here. I do not like standing up here, by the way. This is the most uncomfortable spot for me to be in, because I'm not a good public speaker, and I know it. And trust me, it's unnerving sometimes. My goal, though, my hope is that all hearing will be built up in some way, that the Word of God will reach them and will be encouraged by the Word of God, that they'll be convicted by the Word of God, that the Word of God will go out by whatever means, by Daniel's means, by Don's means, by Randy's means, whoever's up here preaching the word, the goal should be that the word goes out and then it'll come back. Our gifts are to be used correctly and in an organized way. Paul told the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16, he says, and he gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain the unity of the faith, and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. As a result, we are no longer to be children tossed here and there by waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, and by the craftiness and deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in all aspects into him who is the head. Even Christ, from whom the whole body, being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. Paul tells every church that he writes to essentially the same thing. That's your job. Build each other up. Don't divide. Love one another. The second thing that we glean from this is God is not a God of confusion, but of order, and his desire is that all things are to be done decently and in order. We You see, in Corinth, the things were the opposite of decently in order. They were chaos. The whole thing would have been a sight to behold, I imagine, coming in, and just crazy stuff going on. You know, I've never been somewhere where people were trying to one-up the other in speaking. That's never happened. So I can't imagine what that's like, going into a building to worship, and just chaos. Our gifts are to be used in a correct and organized way in worship, not one that initiates chaos, but for the sole purpose of edification. Which takes us back to our first point, edification. I want to go back to my illustration at the very beginning of working at a manufacturing facility. In 2008, I worked on night shift and I was a team leader on one of the lines there. I had a really great team that accomplished a lot of things. We were really good at accomplishing what we needed to in a timely manner. And never really had any problems. I don't believe that it was because of any special person, individual. I was not that great of a leader. I was learning. This was like my first position in a leadership position, so I was fairly fresh. I don't believe there was anybody on my team that was specifically good at their job. Some of them were not that great at their job. And they had to be encouraged, edified. But all of us worked together, and we accomplished our job. And I think the idea was that we enjoyed our job, eventually. When I first came on as a crew leader, nobody liked me. And the reason was I didn't come from that line. Nobody knew me. And so it was kind of like fresh meat. Right? You do that to the new leader. You do that. It was the who's this guy mentality. Like, you don't know what we do here. Why are you trying to tell us what to do? I went away when I worked with them. Instead of lording my position of leadership over them, I got down and worked with them. I learned everybody's job. I did it with them. I didn't treat them like they were lesser than me because they were not lesser than me. My job was different. My role was different. Yes, I was a leader. I had a specific role to fill. But that doesn't mean I was better. That doesn't mean that I was more accomplished than me. I just got the job. We enjoyed coming to work, working with one another, and we got the job done. The environment there is chaos. When you look at a line and you simply plant, it is chaos. If you just want to know what chaos is like, go walk down a line. It's not a pretty thing. Unless the leadership has got unless those on the line realize order is important. Things flow. Stuff happens. Work gets done. Generally, nobody gets hurt. Everybody goes home. It's great. It's a great place to work. When it's the opposite, it's not a great place to work. And nobody's happy. Nobody's edified. And they all just go home angry and want to find a different job. We here as a body of believers work together. We do work together. We come to worship together. We partake in communion together. We sing, pray, and hear the word together. Everything that we do when we're together is together, right? There's no separation. And there's no higher authority within the body. There's not one better than the other. Just as he was fighting against here, there's no reason to consider yourself better than the other. You fulfill different roles, and you should, because there's a lot of different jobs. We proclaim Christ and him crucified together. This is our biggest job, is proclaiming Christ to the world together. As they see us together doing this, this is what convinces people of the Word of God. When they see chaos, when they see disorder, they're not convinced that you believe what you believe, because you're not following the Word of God. I'm going to leave you with Revelation chapter 22. Read with me, starting in verse 12. Behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me, to render to every man according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter by the gate into the city. Outside are the dogs and the sorcerers, the immoral persons, the murderers and the idolaters, and everyone who loves and practices lying. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright and morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who wishes to take the water of life without cost come. That is my lesson this morning. For those who are part of this body, that is our job, is to edify one another, to build one another up. For those who are far off, we're at home, we can't come and worship. We go to their homes, we meet with them, we build them back up so they can be here until they're healthy. Or maybe they won't be healthy. I don't know. But our job is to build up. Our job is to encourage. Whatever your job is in the church, I encourage you to keep doing that job and do it to the best of your ability. If you don't have a job, we'll give you a job. There's plenty of stuff to do. Ultimately, whatever we're doing needs to be done with the other in mind. Not just myself, not just what I want, but what's going to be the best for the body. If you're not a part of this body, and I mean the universal body of Christ, the one that you come into when you put on baptism and walk a new life, then today's the day. That last chapter of Revelation is a great scene for those who are the saved, those who are confident in Christ and the sacrifice that he made. And it's a scary verse for the opposite. It's a scary verse for those who are not in Christ, for those who are outside of Christ. But what a beauty it is to be a part of the brotherhood, to be a part of this family that I get to come see every Sunday and know that I share something great with you all. Whatever side of that fence that you're on, now is the time. This is the invitation time to come and be washed of your sins or to ask for prayers in the congregation to be built up yourself if that's what you need. Come forward now as we stand and sing the invitation song.